This video has been sponsored by NordVPN. Right now, they're offering 75% off 3-year plans, as well as 1 month free, which you can get by going to nordvpn.com/NileRed. As a kid, I can sometimes remember looking through dirt and finding little bits that looked almost like gold. And almost every time, I would get really excited thinking that I was rich or something, only to be quickly shut down and told that it was worthless fool's gold. At the time, I kind of just accepted that answer, and I threw away what I had found without really questioning much. What I didn't know, though, was that despite it being way less valuable than gold, it was still a really interesting compound. The mineral name for fool's gold is pyrite, or iron pyrite, and its chemical name is iron disulfide. Its chemical formula is pretty simple, just FeS2, but what makes it really cool is the different ways that it can crystallize. The appearance that it ultimately takes on will depend heavily on the environment that it was formed in. Some important factors that affect it are things like purity, time, pressure, and temperature. For example, pyrite from a certain region in Spain tends to form these oddly perfect-looking cubes, which honestly still kind of look fake to me. Their size and distribution can also vary quite a bit, and some crystals can get really big like this one. The base unit cell that builds the pyrite crystal is cubic, and under these circumstances, the macroscopic crystal that formed was cubic as well. However, impurities and the other conditions that I mentioned earlier can alter how these units build on each other, and it can affect the final appearance. So depending on where you are in the world and what the geological conditions are in that place, it can look quite different. For this video, I'm going to be focusing on pyrite, but I did want to mention that it is possible for the iron disulfide to have a non-cubic unit cell. It can instead be something called orthorhombic, and when this happens, it forms a different mineral called marcasite. This one's a lot more brittle though, less stable, and has a different color. In any case, now that we know a bit about what fool's gold is in general, I want to dive a bit more into its physical and chemical properties. So to start off, just in appearance and feel, I think it's really similar to metal. And color-wise, it can be close to that of gold, and it's also often found in the same area as gold, so it's not surprising that they can sometimes get mixed up. The biggest difference, though, is that gold is never found as these sharp and highly ordered structures, and it's usually just found as an amorphous chunk like this. And another major difference is that gold is really soft and malleable, whereas pyrite is really hard and brittle. So if it's hit with something like a hammer, the pyrite would shatter into pieces, whereas the gold would just get flattened. Also, in terms of its density, it's only around 5 grams per cubic centimeter, whereas gold is about 19.3. With small quantities, it might be hard to tell, but once you get a decent amount of the pyrite, the weight difference is pretty obvious. So when a big chunk is found, it's relatively easy to tell the difference, and it's only really an issue when you have lots of small bits. For example here, in a clip that I found on YouTube, it really does look like gold. However, this was only because the really shiny pyrite was reflecting a lot of the light from the sun and making it hard to tell its color. Once he moved to the shade though, the brassy yellow color of the pyrite became quite evident, but the color of the gold stayed the same. His other simple test was based on the fact, like I mentioned before, that the density of pyrite is way less than that of gold. Just by gently swishing around the water, the heavier gold is able to stay put, but the lighter pyrite is moved around. From its overall metallic and shiny look, a lot of people would think that it's conductive, and, well, they're right, it kind of is. It's not nearly as conductive as a proper metal, though, and it's classified as a semiconductor. In general, semiconductor materials are used pretty extensively in the electronics industry, and it has been suggested that pyrite might have some use there as well. Currently, I think the major use of it related to things that are electronic is in non-rechargeable energizer lithium batteries. In this battery, one of the electrodes is the lithium itself, and the other one is made by coating iron disulfide on a thin layer of aluminum. Okay, so now for the fun part, where I get to play around with it and learn more about its chemical properties. It would have been insane to sacrifice my really nice cube, so instead, I bought a bunch of ugly ones from eBay. I really don't remember exactly how much it cost, but it was quite cheap and probably only around $20 for the whole bag of them. For the first test, I just put a small amount of concentrated hydrochloric acid on one of the pieces. I let it sit there for a few minutes, but it didn't look like much was happening. There should have been a reaction going on, but I just think it's really slow. The iron disulfide is FeS2, but I thought that it might react faster if I converted it to just FeS. This can be done pretty easily by just heating the pyrite to its decomposition temperature, which starts at around 540°C. To do this, I just carefully shot it with a blowtorch until it looked like the surface was turning black. Some pieces of pyrite also started cracking off, but I'll talk about that in a bit. When it cooled down, I added the HCl again, and the effect was very subtle, but it was there. Like last time, I left it for a few minutes, and when I removed it, almost all of the blackness had disappeared. The HCl had also taken on a yellow color, which you can see on the paper towel. So the major thing that happened here was a reaction between the black iron sulfide that I made and the hydrochloric acid. This led to the formation of iron 2 chloride, as well as hydrogen sulfide gas. The amount that was reacting here was so little, though, that it wasn't really possible to see any gas coming off. However, I wanted the effect to be much clearer, so I decided to try heating the pyrite more and to convert as much as I could to the FeS. Initially, it looked decent and the whole surface was turning black, but then suddenly, pieces of it started to shoot off. I'm not 100% sure what caused this, but I think it is a direct result of the decomposition of the iron disulfide. In order for it to break down to FeS, it needs to kick off a sulfur. It's fine if this happens on the surface of it, because the sulfur just boils off and then burns in the air to make sulfur dioxide. However, if this happens in the cube, there's no place for the sulfur gas to go. So I imagine that it starts building up pressure, and it eventually gets to a breaking point. To a certain extent, there's also probably some water mixed into the mineral, which also can cause it to explode. I continued heating the large piece that remained, and initially some pieces did come off of it, but eventually it stopped. I'm not exactly sure why it stopped breaking apart, but I'm assuming that it was somehow able to release some of the gas pressure. I kept heating it until most of it had become red hot, and then I let it cool down. As it cooled, the surface of it slowly got oxidized by oxygen in the air to make what I assume was red iron 3 oxide. When it eventually got to room temperature, I thought that it was pretty interesting because it didn't look like the fool's gold at all anymore. There was absolutely no goldish yellow color left, and it was all just black and red. Like I just said, I think the red stuff was iron 3 oxide, but I'm not sure if the black stuff was FeS or iron 2 oxide. I tried testing it again by just adding some hydrochloric acid to the surface of it, and it kind of just soaked it up. If you recall from before though, when I tried this with the intact pyrite, the acid just sat there. So apparently as it decomposed, it got a lot more porous. I broke it apart with a hammer, and what I thought was cool was that it was possible to see all the different layers. On the outside was the fully reacted and oxidized stuff, but then right underneath it was a layer of black FeS. Then just below that was the still fully intact FeS2. I really thought that the heat penetrated much deeper, but apparently it didn't. Onto this, I tried adding the hydrochloric acid again, and it worked a bit better. It was possible to see a small amount of bubbling, but it still wasn't as good as I would have liked it to be. To get it to react vigorously, I would need to convert a lot more to the FeS. And to do this, I first had to crush it up. This really isn't very hard to do though, because the pyrite is actually quite brittle. So I just added some of it to a mortar and started bashing it. This was what I had after a few minutes, and I probably could have crushed it a bit more, but I figured this was good enough. This was all added to a test tube, and I did my best to flush it with nitrogen. Then, just like all the other times, I blasted it with a blowtorch. The reason I used the nitrogen was that I hoped without any oxygen present, the sulfur would be able to come off and not get immediately converted to sulfur dioxide. After only heating it a bit, it all started turning black, and I could see that there was a gas being released from the powder. Because of the background, it was hard to see, but there was also a white vapor that had filled the tube. At the time, it didn't occur for me to test it, but it was almost definitely sulfur, maybe along with a bit of water vapor. What I think is cool is that industrially, pyrite is used in a very similar way to this to generate elemental sulfur. Depending on the purpose, the sulfur can be kept as is, Ore can also be converted to sulfur dioxide for the paper industry, or even to sulfur trioxide to make sulfuric acid. When I felt like most of it had converted to FeS, I stopped heating it, and I let it cool. I probably should have refilled the tube with nitrogen though, because as it cooled, the surface was oxidized, and it turned red. I figured this was fine because most of it was still black, but then I mixed things, and saw there was still a whole bunch of pyrite. I apparently had the same issue as before, where it only really converted the stuff on the outside, and the stuff in the center was more or less intact. This time though, I thought I still made more than enough, so I continued on with the testing. When it got to room temperature, I dumped it all onto a dish, and it honestly kind of looked the same. Nonetheless, I took a small sample of it, and I placed it onto another dish, and tried adding hydrochloric acid again. This time, the reaction was way more vigorous, and a gas was definitely being produced. Hydrogen sulfide is extremely potent, and even in small quantities, it smells like rotten eggs. So, a very simple test for it is technically just to try and smell it. This was all done in my fume hood though, which apparently worked quite well, because I didn't smell anything. The only real way for me to smell it would be to bend over and to get really close to it. The problem with this though is that hydrogen sulfide is also super toxic, around the same level as cyanide gas, so I wasn't too excited about trying to take a breath of it. The much smarter thing is to instead use test strips. These are made pretty easily by soaking paper in a solution of lead acetate and then letting it dry. Now, if I was in fact making hydrogen sulfide, then the lead acetate on these strips should be able to react with it to make black lead sulfide. And when I did this, that was exactly what happened. I was making the hydrogen sulfide here mostly as a demo, but in general, it is a useful chemical. In the lab, it's usually produced the same way, where a strong acid is reacted with iron sulfide. However, the iron sulfide is rarely made from pyrite, and it's usually either purchased or made directly by reacting iron and sulfur powder. It leads to an extremely exothermic reaction, and this is a clip from one of the first videos that I ever posted to this channel. The videos that I made back then were totally different, but if you're interested in checking it out, there's a link in the description. In any case, I think that's about it. Pyrite might not be as nearly as valuable as actual gold, but I think it has enough of its own unique properties and uses that it more than makes up for this. And honestly, I think the cheap price is actually a good thing because it means that most people can buy it relatively easily. For example, I think the large cube sample that I have is one of the coolest things that I own, but it only cost me something around $100. In Canadian dollars, that's about 2 grams of gold, which is not only not very much, but also nothing really impressive to look at. In any case, this was the first video that I did on a mineral, and I had a lot of fun doing it. I definitely plan to do this again with another mineral, so in the comments, let me know what you'd like to see. I ended up getting really behind schedule editing this video, so I'm probably going to be posting it from the airport on my way to Japan for vacation. To do this though, I'll have to connect to the public airport Wi-Fi, which isn't really secure and kind of makes me nervous. However, luckily, services like NordVPN exist, which allow me to keep my data safe by encrypting everything that's sent and received by my computer. This way, I can log into all my accounts or even buy things with my credit card without worrying about getting my info or password stolen. On top of this though, there are a whole bunch of other benefits of NordVPN. For example, it has a built-in ad and malware blocker, and it also anonymizes you on the internet, making it difficult to track or spy on your activity. What I especially like is that they have a super easy-to-use app that works on all mobile devices, as well as laptops and desktops. All I need to do is just click one button, and it's done automatically. There is also the option to do it manually though, and you can choose from one of their over 5,000 servers around the world. So with that being said, I've been using NordVPN for about a year now, and I highly recommend it. Also, right now, they're offering a great deal that gives you 75% off their 3-year plan, as well as one extra free month. You can get this by going to nordvpn.com/nilered, or by clicking the link in the description. As a side note, some of you might be wondering why I'm posting the video on the way to Japan, and not when I get there. My answer to this is kind of simple, where A, I don't really want to be working on videos once I get there, and B, I just think it could be fun. I'm going to be having a 14-hour plane ride between Minnesota and Tokyo, and I just thought that it could be interesting to buy Wi-Fi and to answer your comments from the air. As usual, a big thanks goes out to all my supporters on Patreon. Everyone who supports me can see my videos at least 24 hours before I post them to YouTube. Also, everyone on Patreon can directly message me, and if you support me with $5 or more, you'll get your name at the end like you see here.